And how amazing that God has never left the world without a witness of some sort. From the time he put Adam and Eve in there, right? Perfect world. Every generation has had some kind of witness, something that teaches us in each of our generations that we're placed on the earth. Are you glad you live in this time period? Oh, yeah. If not, you know, we could go back to some of these other time periods. And most of us sitting in here would already be dead. You know, with your lifespan of 30 or 40 years back in the day. Of course, you got married when you were 14, so 13. Right? Yeah. So just so thankful that we live in this time. And what can happen at any time? The rapture, right? The air rescue. The major rescue from whatever is going on in our lives right now could just be over in a twinkling of an eye. That's a really cool thing. Wouldn't it be amazing? You wouldn't have to worry about where you're working. Wouldn't have to worry about, let's see, I get paid this week, so yay! I get paid once a month. So it's like, you know, you wouldn't have to worry about any of that stuff or your family and, you know, all the things that are going on in your own personal family. Like, what? You don't have to worry about any of that. Of course, we're not supposed to worry about it anyway, right? Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, with prayer and supplication. Yes. We're going to let God know what's going on, and I know you do. There's a story that is told here about 12 boys who were ages 11 to 16. And they were all from Thailand, and they were on a soccer team. And after their practice, they went with their coach to this really cool cave in northern Thailand. Y'all remember this story? 2018 just happened. And they had gone two of that big cavern, this big tunnel. They had gone two of the 6 miles when it started raining. And when it rains in Thailand, it's a monsoon. And it happened to rain a little bit more this afternoon than normal. And it flooded the caves and trapped those kids in 2 miles in, which was the problem. If it had been, you know, 500 meters or half, you know, whatever, it would have been a little different. But 2 miles in, and they were on this underground ledge in the cavern. And so when the families, you know, figured out, where are these kids? They should have been back by now. And the wives of the coaches and things, when all that got reported, they sent out a search party and found their bikes and their backpacks near this cave entrance. So the authorities, of course, started trying to get these kids out and realized they didn't have the capacity, the tools, or anything to get these kids out. So what happens is, of course, it goes global, and the Army, the U.S. Army sends in the Navy SEALs, right? I'm sorry, the U.S. Army didn't send in the Navy SEALs. The Navy sent in the Navy SEALs. You know where that came from. It's okay. And when they entered the caverns, they had to, of course, you know, the waters were very murky, so it took them some time to find these boys, and they described it as swimming through coffee. Swimming through coffee. So it was so muddy, yes, swimming through coffee. So unfortunately, additional rains and rushing water prevented further penetration, so they bring in pumps to try to lower the water level. And the divers were set up at air pumps at intervals along the passages, so because it was 2 miles, so they had to stop at, you know, different little stations, and to create breathing stations that would help them move deeper into the caverns. Also thinking, you know, if we find these boys, how are we going to get them out? Because these kids aren't trained in underwater, you know, diving. So after 9 days, they finally locate the boys and delivered them survival supplies while they were trying to figure out how to get them out. And over the next week, they strung the underwater guide wires between these underwater stations to take out the boys. And they would have to take them out, you know, one at a time with scuba, you know, gear and actually one boy with two experienced divers at a time. And then pray that the little boys wouldn't panic. Anybody got claustrophobia in here? Wow. So the first round trip took 11 hours. And with two experienced divers, with eight guys, they brought out four boys. And then they had, of course, the subsequent trips. And they went faster. It just took them after they figured out, you know, where they were going and what they were doing. So all the boys were brought out safely, and of course the world applauds the efforts of these two men for each child. That's the point I'm trying to make. Two men, because we're talking about how many witnesses today. Two witnesses. This, you know, rescue effort seemed probably impossible and, of course, very dangerous. But, you know, the world could have just written off those boys and nobody done anything about it, you know, and, well, you know, this is what happened. They made a stupid choice. They shouldn't have gone, you know, into those caverns when they know it's monsoon season. And, you know, how we can, you know, talk about things. Oh, that was, they shouldn't have done that. And this happened. And it would have been easier to, you know, just let that go. But no, you're talking about kids 11 to 16. And, you know, God, too, could easily, using that logic, well, you know, you made a stupid decision. I'm just going to let it go. You know, you chose to do that. You think about all the stupid stuff I have chosen. I'm not going to say you, that I have chosen to do in my lifetime. And God using that, well, that was dumb kind of logic could have written me off. But what about the people who, because they haven't chosen to be saved and they're caught in that deadly trap on that underwater ledge of the tribulation? Because they haven't been born again. I got some loved ones that aren't. We all do. That would go through the tribulation. But God's not going to write off, you know, a lot of people. Because we saw that around the throne, all the tribulation saints from the 144,000. At the beginning of the tribulation, everybody get that? Strong delusion starts immediately with the catching away of the saints. Good question. And the two witnesses are going to start at the beginning of the tribulation for the first 3.5 years. 144,000 go the entire 7 years. Okay? 144,000 witnesses, the Jewish young men we talked about last week, will witness the entire 7 years. They'll believe the lie. Because whatever, you know, strong delusion it is to where they're blinded, they're going to, the authorities are going to come up with some kind of explanation for the rapture. They're going to explain it away. And they're going to give all kinds of theories. Whether it was aliens came and got you on the spaceship. Remember the Hellbop thing that happened? Where all those people committed suicide and they, you know, thought they were going to catch Halley's Comet a couple years back. Mm-mm, that didn't happen. But whatever the theory's going to be, why people are captured or caught away, the people are going to believe that lie, and then you're going to see without Holy Spirit on the earth, you think about it, without salt and light on the earth, what people believe and what's going to be there. So that strong delusion, you know, on whoever it falls upon and they accept it, it'll make it, you know, next to impossible for them to believe. And he says it's going to happen. That's why it's the day of grace. Scary. people who've already received all that light. Mm-hmm. Right. Scary to think about. Well, you got, again, you know, the God will send rescuers for the billions who will be groping in darkness. And these voices, there's going to be two voices to proclaim the gospel. And it's going to be that lifeline, like the divers had from the end of the tunnel to bringing those kids out. And they'll be, you know, pulling those kids out, two people, one kid at a time. And at the beginning of the rapture, immediately after the rapture takes place, God in his infinite love will never leave men and women who want to turn to him, who want to turn to him. There it is, who want to turn to him and will be able to after that strong delusion. So John 11, let's go ahead and start with that. Everybody with me? All right, here we go. Then I was given, in the wrong place. Let's go to verse 3. Actually, I am going to start in verse 1. I'm sorry. Then I was given a reed like a measuring rod, and the angel stood, saying, "Rise and measure the temple of God, the altar, and those who worship there. But leave out the court which is outside the temple, and do not measure it, for it has been given to the Gentiles. And they will tread the holy city underfoot for 42 months." In my study this week, that verse 1 and 2 came to light for me. I didn't really know what exactly it meant until I was studying this. And you know where the Dome of the Rock is right now, where they believe that it was built over the Temple Mount? Right? The Dome of the Rock is the Muslim temple. And so this makes sense that the original temple site, some Bible scholars believe, is leave out the court which is outside the temple and do not measure it, for it has been given to the Gentiles, is actually where the Dome of the Rock is, and that the actual Temple Mount is a little further north of that. I was like, oh, you're kidding me. That was cool. I thought that was really neat. So whenever the angel was told to go and measure the temple of God and the altar and those who worship, that part that's outside the temple, don't measure it because it's given to the Gentiles, represents the Dome of the Rock. And they will tread the city underfoot for 42 months, and I will give power to my two witnesses. This is going to be 3.5 years. I will give power to my two witnesses, and they will prophesy 1,260 days, the 3.5 years, clothed in sackcloth. So he says that after the rapture takes place, he's going to send two witnesses. Now, what the big debate is always who the two witnesses are. Well, honestly, we're going to talk about that, but it's honestly what's their message and what they are going to be able to do to people who are going to... Now, you've got the people who are the questioning type. As Antichrist rises to power, this world leader, there's going to be those that are going to stand back and go, you sure what this guy said is really going to come to, is really true? And then you got these two witnesses that are going to be proclaiming truth, proclaiming truth, proclaiming truth. Somebody's going to sit back and listen to these two witnesses. That's what God says is going to happen. Go ahead, Mr. Robert. Right. Makes a big impact. Most, yes. Yeah, and what they died for, yeah. Like Stephen Arigato, the guy we talked about that was on the beach, and all the people said, you know, no, I believe in Jesus, and he said, no, I believe in their God. Absolutely. Amen. Amen. Well, when you look at this, and it says, I will give power to my two witnesses. I will give power. Let's look at their personalities and the identity of who they possibly are. Because if God has given them power, there's been other people who've come before that he's given power. But I want to throw this at you, and I want you to contemplate this. Has God not given each of you sitting in here power? Look at what he's given you power over. Or power to withstand, or power to have the knowledge to understand what's going on around you may seem real, but it's really not. That there's this other plan going on, and you need to walk in that plan that it doesn't look like it is, but it really is. Does that make sense to anybody? That plan is going on, that and your circumstances look impossible, but there's a greater plan going on behind those circumstances, that God is working out things. And, you know, I see it happening all the time. You know, people, something happens in their lives, and it draws people to the Lord, and they get saved. Well, that's the most important thing, right? What's your ticket to heaven? Salvation. So that would be where you would, you know, whatever that trial or tribulation is that drives us closer to the Lord, that increases our faith and helps us to understand a little bit more of who He is and who we are. That's the big plan there. So I think about, you know, who these people are, that they were given power to be, some Bible commentators say that they're representatives or they're symbolic of the Old Testament law and the Old Testament prophets. Because in your reading, who does Dr. Jeremiah tell you that they possibly could be? Three people: Moses, Elijah, Enoch. Okay, so Moses would represent the law, Old Testament law, and Elijah would represent the Old Testament prophets. Now Enoch, you know, great guy, and he didn't die, and he did walk off with God, and Elijah did get into a flaming chariot and was taken off, and Moses' body was argued over between Satan and so it could be him as well, because nobody knows where he was buried, right? So it's these two anointed ones. And so John's readers, whenever he started talking about this, we could go back to in verse 4. These are the two olive trees and the two lampstands standing before the God of all the earth. And the people who read that in that day would understand that, and they would recognize that as metaphors from the book of Zechariah. Because in Zechariah it says that he identifies the olive trees as actual people, and Zechariah 4:14, which was in your lesson, the two anointed ones who stand beside the Lord of the whole earth. And these two anointed ones in Zechariah's prophecy were prominent men of faith at that time, and they actually represented Joshua, the high priest, and Jerusalem's governor, Zerubbabel. So they would have been aware of those men in their Hebrew history of Joshua. And the scripture calls him Jeshua, the high priest, and Zerubbabel, the governor of Jerusalem at that time. And they restored the Jewish temple at that point. And some of these readings, of course, are in Nehemiah and those things. But we can see it again in Zechariah. So in Zechariah's day, Joshua and Zerubbabel were two witnesses. In Zechariah 14:6-10, it talks about how they were two witnesses to Jerusalem in that day, and their work really fueled the work in that day, and they were like olive branches supplying the oil to the people of that day, the strength, the belief. And you could be like that too. You could be that person who provides strength to other people, and you don't even know it, right? Two or more gather. Mm-hmm. Right. Right. And he's the power shall be done. It does. Amen. 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 Well, groups of two. Yeah. To get those. his boys out. Amen. Amen. Well said. Well, the purpose of them is clear. Their identity, of course, is the controversy. So let's talk about why scholars believe it's Elijah. And, of course, I'm going to be telling you what you already read in your lesson. Malachi prophesied that Elijah would return to prepare the way for Christ's second coming, right? He said, "Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And he will turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the hearts of the children to their fathers." That's in Malachi 4, 5 through 6. Now, some believe, of course, that John the Baptist fulfilled this because he came in the power of Elijah. And Luke 1, 17 tells us that John the Baptist came in the power, spirit and power of Elijah. But that means that he did his work by the Holy Spirit, just as Elijah did. John was not literally Elijah incarnated. And John affirmed this fact because he was asked, the Jewish leader said, "Are you Elijah?" And in John 1:21, he said, "I am not." So Malachi's prophecy clearly points to someone who was yet to come, because it says, "Before the great and dreadful day of the Lord." Now, we just said God took Elijah up into heaven. And in our lesson today, isn't that what's going to happen to the two witnesses? They're going to be what? Physically resurrected and taken up into heaven. And the two witnesses are also like Elijah. They're going to prevent rain from falling for 3.5 years, because Elijah did that in 1 Kings 17:1. Also, remember when Elijah called fire down from heaven? And that was 2 Kings 1:10. Yes, ma'am. They're going to be resurrected in 3.5 days, and raptured up. But everybody's going to see it. It's not going to happen in a twinkling of an eye. Yes. Yeah. It's almost like he shows us again, y'all, this stuff's really going to happen, that there's actually going to be a rapture. There really is. So it is amazing. The other thing that brings us to who the person could be Elijah is because the drought that he imposed will last exactly 3.5 years, just like it did in 1 Kings 17:1. And Luke talks about it in Luke 4, and James talks about it in James 5. So this is exactly the duration of their ministry. So you realize it's not going to rain during those first 3.5 years while all the seals are happening as well. Wow. That's going to be a tough time to live on the planet Earth. Gracious. Okay, and so Elijah, you know, was taken up in a chariot of fire. So he can come back down, right? All right, the other guy is Moses. And here's why Bible scholars think it's Moses. Both Moses and Elijah appeared at Christ's transfiguration, so they were able to come down and meet with him. That's in Matthew 17:3. Also, they're going to have the power to turn water into blood. Well, who did that? Moses did. Absolutely. So by God's power, Moses turned water into blood in Exodus 7:19 through 20. And the two witnesses will do that, and we'll look at that in verse 6 in a minute. Moses' body was miraculously preserved for restoration in Deuteronomy 34, 5 through 7. When the witnesses die, their bodies will also be restored, and we'll see that when they resurrect. So there's the connection between Moses. Satan fought the archangel Michael for possession of Moses' body in Jude, verse 9, and he may have intended, this is cool, to prevent God's program of restoration in the last days. Okay? And so you think about what was the battle there in the heavenlies, knowing what Satan knowing. Y'all know Satan knows God's word better than you and I do. Yeah. He does. You got to give him that now. And so Moses represents the law and Elijah the prophets. I already said that. So, you know, the nation of Israel is going to get that as they minister to the Jewish people. Now, they're going to be ministering to everybody. But what did you learn in the 144,000? God's people are going to turn to him. The Jewish people are going to turn to him in mass groves. Amazing. Now, there's two Bible scholars, Timothy Demme and John Whitcomb, and they say that it's probably Moses and Elijah, and I'd like to read this to you. No two men in Israel's entire history would receive greater respect and appreciation than Moses and Elijah. Moses was God's great deliverer and lawgiver, and first century Jews actually thought that Moses had given them the manna in the wilderness, not God. And God raised up Elijah to confront Israel in a time of great national apostasy under that crazy Ahab and Jezebel. God vindicated him by sending fire from heaven and a chariot of fire and horses of fire to escort him out of this world. So highly did the Jews of Jesus' day think of Elijah that when they saw Jesus' miracles, some people concluded that Elijah had returned and that he was called Elijah in Matthew 16:14. So their witness, their prophecies, the things that they're going to do, and you see in verse 3, it says they're going to be, you know, they're going to prophesy in verse 3, prophesy 1,260 days. And they're going to be clothed in sackcloth, which is the picture of a prophet. Remember, of course, John and Elijah. Yes. Yeah, go. Probably for this. So they wouldn't worship him. Oh. There you go. Then he shouldn't receive a proper burial because of his sin. Well, there goes all of us then. Wow. I've heard others say so that Moses wouldn't be worshipped, that God was careful about where he was buried so that the people wouldn't worship Moses. Yeah, I heard preachers preach that. Enter the kingdom of heaven. Who knows? I mean, I think that they are up there, of course, alive. They could be in a physical body and God could be taking care of them. Or they could be in a spiritual body the way everybody else is. He can do it however he wants to. And the scripture doesn't really tell us how they are. So I don't actually, you know, not based on scripture, I don't have anything for you. But I think that, you know, he probably gave them a body that they could live there. Because he's going to take care of everything. So, I mean, there's not an answer to, because there's, we're not told how they, or how they're living there. But they are. And they're going to incarnate and come back. Which, of course, they could be given a physical body because, you know, God took on a physical body. He can do it any way he wants to. Yeah, could have been changed. Right. Yeah, he could do it any way he wants to. Yeah. But he's got it going on, though. I mean, you know, they're up there. And they're coming back. That's a good point. They were spiritual bodies then. There you go. Well, you got these guys that are prophesying, and the Bible tells us that they're confirming truths, and they're complying with the legal standards of Jewish law, because, like Mr. Larry said earlier, you got to have two witnesses to establish anything. And because Deuteronomy, of course, tells us that if there's somebody deserving of death and they're put to death, it has to be on the testimony of two or three witnesses. And these two witnesses are confirming God's message. And you think about it, when when God has sent people out, there's lots of examples in the scripture that he pairs people to perform his missions. He put Moses and Aaron together. He put Joshua and Caleb together. He put Zerubbabel and Joshua, as I already mentioned. He put Peter and John. He put Paul and Silas. He put Timothy and Titus. He sent the 70 out in pairs of two. He sent the apostles out in pairs of two. And so these two witnesses are going to confirm God's message of judgment. Now, they're going to be filled with the Spirit of God and empowered with speech and actions to convict their audiences of coming judgment. And their messages are going to be so judgmental. I saw a guy in Walmart yesterday. It said, only God is my judge. Right? It said, don't judge me. Only God is my judge. And so we're supposed to be careful. Don't judge anything before it's time. But in that day, that crowd's going to be preaching judgment. Because the 7 years of tribulation is a time of judgment. Grace and mercy is over with. So they're going to provoke intense hatred. And we can understand why. You just think about it. We've probably never heard just face to face somebody telling you just how awful and bad you are, probably except your mama or your dad. These two witnesses are going to tell to the teeth how hard and godless this nation is. This globe, and this globe that is ready to worship the devil, and just what they are before God. They're going to warn of the disasters of the tribulation period and tell the people that their judgments that the people have brought down upon themselves by rejecting Christ as Lord and Savior. They're going to accuse the people of turning Jerusalem, because they're going to be in Jerusalem, God's holy city, into a pit of depravity. They're going to refute the claims of the Antichrist and expose the Antichrist for who he really is. Can you imagine? And this is going to be all over the world because the media will, because it says it will go out to all the peoples of the world. And we're in that time period where it can. We got the systems to do it. And so they're going to refute the Antichrist for the Satan-controlled being that he is. They'll denounce that the lie that man is innately good and improvable. We've heard of the social teachings that I'm good, you're good, we're all good. And if we're good, we're going to die and go to heaven just because you're good. Oh, no, 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 no. Oh, no. There you go. And what else is Jeremiah 17? That the heart is wicked, desperately wicked. Who can know it? Woo! They're going to warn of the terrible judgments to come if the people don't turn from their gross depravity. And we see it in our own day. Don't we? Unbelievers who that do not merely reject the truth, they go all out to silence it. We have parades and we have protests of people who want their rights. Again, we have no rights when we're born again, do we? Everything that we have and who we are is Jesus. Why? Because planted in every heart. Why are people going to know that what the two witnesses are saying is correct? And you guys, we're in Revelation 11 talking about the two witnesses. In every heart is the knowledge of right and wrong. God's planted that there. We have a conscience that we're born with. And this knowledge is stifled and buried when people give themselves over to sinful behavior. And to hear truth proclaimed arouses the ire and the hatred and the anger that people can have when they're confronted with the truth. And it brings forth our consciences and inflicts guilt. And people who are unbelievers and sinners cannot tolerate guilt. When people get guilty, have you ever had somebody turn on you all of a sudden and they start hollering at you about something and you're thinking, you're describing yourself. you're mad at me over something that you're doing. Because guilt is powerful. And explains why the message of these two people will outrage the people. And the people of the earth will demand the deaths of these two witnesses. And so it tells us, go on to Revelation 11, verse 5. It says there, verse 4 says, there are the two olive trees and the two lampstands that stand before the God of the earth. And if anyone wants to harm them, here's the power God gives them. Not only to speak truth, fire proceeds from their mouth and devours their enemies. Y'all ever seen those World War I and World War II old documentaries? They have those flamethrowers. Yeah. That's some bad boys right there. When that flame comes out of that gun and he's got that stuff on his back and it's and fire's going to proceed from the mouths of these men and devour their enemies. I'll bet nobody gets too close to them. I bet they got cord on, you know, that the police cord. They might have them cord on off. They sit there in the city square of Jerusalem because those flamethrowers, and it's going to come from their mouths? Aren't you glad God hadn't given you that? Man, I had it already, nukes and people. Shwa. That's what I think of you. Right? At any given moment of any anger? Yeah. So I'm so glad the Lord gives it to these men who can handle it. And it says if anybody wants to harm them, he must be killed in this manner. Now go on in verse 6, it says they have the power to shut heaven so that no rain falls in the days of their prophecy. And they have power over waters to turn them to blood and to strike the earth with all plagues as often as they desire. Anybody can handle that but Moses and Elijah. Right? Nobody can handle that but them. Wow. So the plague of death is given to them. The plague of drought is given to them. The plague of disease is given to them. And so you think of all the things. None of these miracles that they're given will be done out of anger or vindictiveness like I am totally capable of. I know you're not. Y'all are all so good. We're all good, aren't we? We're all okay. So when we're asleep, exactly. When you're having, even if you have REM stage, you're still dreaming crazy stuff. There's nothing good about us. There's nothing. There's none righteous, no, not one, apart from Jesus. And he's the only one that can surely help me love and surely help me do anything at all. So none of these miracles are going to be done out of anger. Their primary purpose will be, listen, and JB, you said this. Remember, they're going to be deluded. Their primary purpose will be to shake people out of their delusion that all is well. And to convict them of sinfulness and to awaken their need to repent. One effect of the preaching and the miracles of the witness, these two witnesses, may be that the turmoil they arouse will delay the completion of the Antichrist's quest for world domination. That the thing that they may do is slow it down just a little bit, because Antichrist is coming to power. But these witnesses are going to be telling people about the gospel. And and that's going to slow things down just a bit because there will be people who will be saved. Only when they are annihilated and out of the Antichrist way will his path be open to rise completely to power. Again, God sends a witness. He does it in our day. He's done it in my life. How many times has he sent you somebody? Over and over and over. Amazing. I told y'all the story when I went to college with my best friend from Hickory, and we were just going to, have a good time. Well, after a couple months we got there, she started going to a Bible study and got saved, and I thought, what? Remember me telling you that? You know? And then, anyway, just crazy stuff. God kept saying, you're going to go this far and no further. You're going to go this far and no further, Mary Beth. Well, I wasn't Rogers then. So the witness that God keeps sending us, and they're going to be persecuted. And let's go to and finish this up. When they finish their testimony, do you hear me? God's appointed every day for us to finish our testimony. When he's finished with your testimony on the earth, he's going to take you home. Yay. When they finish their testimony, the beast that ascends out of the bottomless pit will make war against them.